Amen. All God's people said amen. It's great to be in the Lord's house today, and we're glad that each one of you are here. And this day is a day that God has given us to worship Him and to enjoy being with Him and with one another, especially in the early service this morning, because it tends to be a little bit older on average than this service. We have more and more people coming back for the first time, and so I don't know. I don't look around today. I don't think I see anybody back for the first time in this service. But we're glad you're here, no matter how many times you've been here. If you're visiting with us today, I know we have some in the parking lot. I heard Brother Delmer's out there this morning, so we're excited about him being out there, and others that I'm probably not aware of, many who are at home. Wherever we are, God is excited that we're here. And wherever we are, God is there. And I'm going to read a passage of Scripture out of Psalm 139 that reminds us that over this past year of being involved in the pandemic, and things have been different, and things have made us uncomfortable oftentimes, and things make us feel like, well, we don't know where everybody is, and everybody doesn't know where we are, but God's in control of all of that. So Psalm 139 reminds us by a question, where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you're there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost part of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall fall on me, even the night shall be light about me. Indeed, the darkness shall not hide from you, but the night shines as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to you. So it doesn't matter where you are today, at home, if you're in the parking lot, if you're in this room, you may feel like you're even potentially in a crowd and people don't understand you. People don't know what you're going through. The Lord knows. And so wherever we are today, the Lord's aware of the situation we're in, and He can minister to us and reach us in that place. And we're glad that you're either tuned in or in the room this morning. Let's go to the Lord and ask Him to bless us as we pray. Lord, thank you that over the last year, very surely, Lord, we have felt isolated from one another and not together the way we'd like to be. But God, we thank you that you remind us in your word that we're never apart from you. And the things we're going through, you're aware of. God, thank you that you are God of every circumstance. Nothing's taking you by surprise. There's no one who has hidden themselves from you. And Lord, I pray today that we would be aware of your presence. Lord, that we'd be aware of our failure and sin and shortcoming, and Lord, that we would call upon you for salvation for those who have not been saved, and for those that have wandered, God, that you would draw them home through repentance. And God, for those that are lonely and need fellowship, Lord, we pray that you would let them know that you're there. And God, that you would encourage each one of us in the way that we need, that you would reprove, rebuke, correct in the ways that are needed. And God, that you would allow us to enjoy our fellowship with one another, our fellowship with you, and Lord, that our worship today would be enjoyable for you in your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Oh,
Give God a hand clap of praise, and you can be seated. As Brother Mike says, that'll get you rocking this morning. All right. I came in here on Wednesday, and they were preparing the music for today and making some song selections, and they mentioned that one. I said, oh, the church always loves that one. They love to sing it. It kind of gets our blood flowing and gets our mind on some eternal realities that even though we're going through times that we're not a fan of with some of the pandemic and isolation and sickness and certainly death, there's a day coming where he's going to come and he's going to split the eastern sky, and it's going to be all right. The redeemed in Christ will rise first, and we will rise and meet him in the air, and it's going to be okay. And so sometimes as we're going through difficult circumstances, we have to remind ourselves, it's going to be all right. We're on the winning side. I think of times in my life where I've been a part of something where somebody won. It gets kind of exciting when your team wins, doesn't it? When your side is victorious. And we have that to look forward to this morning. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Matthew 18. We're going to be talking about the idea of greatness today. Our world loves to talk about great things. People love to argue about who's going to win an election. They love to argue about what's their favorite stock market tip and which stock's going to rise and which one's going to be the best bet to put their financial future on. People love to argue about who's the best sports team or who's the best sports player in a specific area. In 2020, with hindsight, we would often get to the end of a year like last year and look backward and say, well, what was the best this or the most watched movie or the most listened to song? And I remember being a kid, people would always want to do the countdowns at the end of the year and what was the most important thing. In time, people argue about who's the most important person. If you look and go online, you can find all kind of lists of importance, list of greatness, if you will. I found two different ones because they were different. I was going to share one list. List number 10, most significant person in history is Thomas Jefferson. Below or above that, depending on how you go, and toward number one, Alexander the Great. These are significant people, not necessarily wonderful people. Then after that was somebody as awful as Adolf Hitler. William Shakespeare, Muhammad was number three on this list. Napoleon, and number one was Jesus. And so I was, all right, they got Jesus number one. Well, then I depressed myself because I looked at another site and thought, I wonder who they think was number one. That one I just read was based on searches and algorithms on the internet about significance. This one was based on somebody's opinion, and they had people like number 10, Albert Einstein, number 9, Christopher Columbus, Gutenberg with the printing press at 8, Confucius up at number 5, Buddha at number 4, Jesus at number 3, and I was aggravated when I saw that. And it got even worse when number 2 was Isaac Newton. That part didn't bother me quite so bad, but Muhammad at number 1. And I was just gritting my teeth while I was doing that little bit of research and getting mad. I thought, well, you know what? As long as this is up to somebody's opinion, they could have said Snoopy at number 1, and it wouldn't have mattered because that's just somebody's opinion. It's what somebody says. Well, our text today calls us to think about greatness. And how we rank greatness, importance, significance. If you'll stand with me, we're going to read in Matthew 18, and we're going to begin in verse 1, and we're going to see a conversation between Jesus and his disciples on this topic. Greatness. How do you rank greatness? At that time, the disciples came to Jesus saying, "Who then is greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" Then Jesus called a little child to him and set him in the midst and said, "Assuredly I say to you, unless you are converted and become as this little child, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever humbles himself as this little child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever receives one little child like this in my name receives me. But whoever causes one of these little ones who believes in me to sin, it would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were drowned in the depths of the sea. Woe to the world because of offenses. For offenses must come, but woe to the man by whom the offenses come. If your hand or foot causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you. It is better for you to enter into life lame or maimed rather than having two hands or two feet to be cast into the everlasting fire. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you, for it is better for you to enter into life with one eye rather than having two eyes to be cast into hellfire. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to come and gather. We thank you for your word, that it is perfect, it's powerful. Lord, it applies, it's pertinent to where we are today in our world, in this church, in our lives. God, we pray that you would apply your word and accomplish your will. We pray for souls to be saved and lives to be changed, for this church to be revived in its ministry of the gospel from children to other children, from the children of God to the lost children of this world. Lord, we pray that we would go as your ambassadors with your good news. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. Again, I'd like to say thank you for being here today as we think about how we rank greatness. I think a lot of people's measuring sticks have been recalibrated in the last year. What matters? What's most important? What takes precedence or priority above the other things? How will we recalibrate ourselves in hopefully eventually a post-pandemic world? We're not there yet, but one day we pray to enter into a post-pandemic era. But even if we don't, how will we rank greatness and importance and significance in a pandemic? In the opportunity that God gives us of this moment on this day, how will we rank greatness? Greatness is following Jesus as little children, according to this scripture. And greatness, according to this scripture, is not only following him as children, but also calling others to follow him as children too. So as children of God, birthed in by your humble faith, we are calling others to come as children and be born in humble faith. Greatness is always a thing of great debate. I mentioned in the early service that for some, especially I think maybe who track sports, you may be familiar with the term GOAT, G-O-A-T. That is an acronym, I think you would call it. It's an abbreviation for greatest of all time. And I mentioned that in the early service, and one of the men came up to me earlier or after that. He said, I didn't know what that meant. I heard somebody talking about so-and-so was the GOAT, and I thought that was an insult. No, if somebody calls you the GOAT, normally that is a big compliment, okay? So nobody ever calls me that, greatest of all time of anything, but and the person that was telling me that he had heard that, I couldn't believe they were saying it of him either, but maybe they were calling him an old GOAT, and that was something different. But if you're searching the internet or somebody's on a television sports broadcast and says something like, LeBron James is the GOAT, okay, that is the greatest of all time. Or perhaps it's something else like boxing. I went all the way back, and some of you will remember, but this was before some of you were born, a fighter, a boxer by the name of Muhammad Ali, or before that, Cassius Clay, who made that phrase, I am the greatest. He made that famous because he was sort of a poet, actually, and he wrote a poem, and it was called I Am the Greatest. I will earn points with our English teachers because I looked up a poem, I Am the Greatest by Cassius Clay. This is the legend of Cassius Clay, the most beautiful fighter in the world today. He talks a great deal and brags indeedy, a muscular punch that's incredibly speedy. Sounds like Dr. Seuss, but that's a different sermon. The fistic world was dull and weary with a champ like Liston. Things had to be dreary. Then some color, some dash, brought the fans a-running with cash. The brash young boxer is something to see, and the heavyweight championship is his destiny. I am Cassius Clay, the greatest fighter in the world today. Well, you know what? It turned out to be true. He was and did become, after that, the greatest fighter in the world at that time. And some may say that he's still the greatest fighter of the world. That's the debate, and we're not going to get into it. One of the hardest things about preparing this sermon was on the internet looking for things like who's the GOAT or the greatest of all time. And I ran into all sorts of things like YouTube videos about the greatest running back of all time. And now I know for sure that it was Walter Payton. That's what it said on the internet, so it had to be true. And some of you are saying, no, it's not true. And you're going to come tell me it was Terrell Davis in the year that he won, that Denver won the championship, and he had all those touchdowns. And so everybody's got some idea about something you're interested in and what makes great people great. And some of the ladies are saying, well, that's just a bunch of childish 50-year-old men arguing about stuff that nobody ought to argue about. And I would say to you, yeah, that's what I'm going to say as a childish 50-year-old man. We argue about things that nobody ought to argue about. But you know what? The Bible tells us that Jesus had some disciples, and they argued about things that nobody ought to argue about either. And I would tell you, it's probably better to argue about who's the greatest running back of all time rather than what they were arguing about. But what we find, number one today in our outline, is a child's conversation. A child's conversation often deals with things they ought not be talking about. Things that we're not qualified for, things that are none of our business, things that are beyond our scope and pale of our life, and what we can do anything about it. But it tells us in verse 1 that Jesus was there and his disciples were having this awful discussion like children do. Who then is greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Now, they weren't qualified to know. They weren't qualified to determine. They weren't qualified in any way. And that's really what Jesus begins to point out, is that you're not even qualified. One thing about life, if you know any children or you ever were a child, can you remember ever talking about things you had no business talking about? Arguing about things that you couldn't resolve? And often a child will just go down to the nitty-gritty of the point of saying, well, says who? And you say, well, says you. And they say, well, that's what you say. And they say, well, that's what you say. And you just get really immature when you're a child and you just argue about things because someone said so. Well, Jesus intervenes as his disciples are asking the question, who is the greatest of all time? Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus doesn't even really give an answer at first. What Jesus does with this childish conversation is issue a child's call. While they're arguing about greatness, he just waves to a little toddler. We don't know how old, but the interpretation of the word lends us to believe probably a toddler. One that could come, at least, to him. And we don't know if he cried out or he waved or both, perhaps. And here this little child comes into the circle. You have to envision this in your mind's eye. These 12 men gathered around, and Jesus there, at least 13 people, maybe more, but 13 at least. And here's this little child that comes and inserts himself by a calling into the middle of all this adult stuff. I want you to think about how we deal with children in the church today. How we deal with ourselves as children of the church today, and realize that in the middle of what we think are a lot of really important conversations, Jesus brings a child right into the middle of it. You ever had a child get in the middle of an adult conversation? Honestly, how do we feel about that? Can I just speak on behalf of all of us? That's just annoying. Grown-ups are in the room, and we're trying to talk about something important and mature and serious, like politics. And here comes a kid right in the middle of what we're doing and interrupts things. I can remember, and if I couldn't remember it, we'd have it on home video. We'd be at Mom's house or something. We'd be having a big family gathering, and Madison, 4 or 5 years old, screaming at the top of her lungs, just running circles around the couch. You know, you can't ignore that. You just scream. If you go to Mom and Dad's house now, we all scream at one another. I think, why are we so loud when we talk? It's like, because we have to scream over the four-year-olds. So we just got in the habit of doing that. And then sometimes in those videos, it'd be Madison running around the couch, and she'd be chasing Noah, her cousin, around again. They'd both be screaming. Just. And I remember in my mature, grown-up adult spirit, all the righteousness of that, just get so aggravated. Why can't they just be quiet so we can talk about important stuff? Well, because they're kids. They're just doing what kids do. Being what kids are. This past Wednesday night, we were sitting there, and I was trying to enjoy my barbecue chicken wing. Thank you, Keith, and all the kitchen crew, because I had barbecue from this ear. My wife said I had all of this ear, and I was enjoying it. I was just eating my barbecue chicken wing. And there's these kids over here at the table. And they were saying things like, do you like me? Would you like me more than you like her? Do you like her more than you like him? And they were trying to make this rating system. Now, it wasn't like boy, girl, like Valentine's like. It was like just, do you like me? Are you my friend? Do you like me better? Who do you like the most? And then they were getting, and then we got, and then I hate you. And that's one of my things that you're not supposed to hate. And I really don't like kids hating one another. So I get up and I have to go intervene in that because I'm an adult after all. I didn't look like an adult. I had barbecue from here to here. But anyway, I was real hard to take serious when I'm lecturing them about hating. I look like the Joker off Batman, you know. But I did, nevertheless. And then I thought I'd solved it, and I went back down. I was sitting again, and here come another kid. So, now, they said you hated me, and they said you liked me. I had to go have that conversation again because kids have those kind of conversations. Adults think it's our job to solve all those conversations. But what we find is God is reminding us, I think, through Jesus, that at least we ought to have a place where kids can be. And where kids can be in the middle of what's going on here. Because it's a dangerous thing for us to get to be a church to think that the best thing that can happen is us not have the nuisance and the interruption of having the kids interrupt our major stuff that we do. After all, we have these big conversations we need to have. And these kids are in the way, bickering and fighting about things like who's the most important. And actually, Jesus shows us that sometimes it's the kid that, although it's an interruption, it's making the adults quit talking about what adults talk about, which is often the same grown-up, mature version of, do you like him more than you like me? Who's the most important? That's what the disciples were arguing about. And here Jesus puts a child in the middle of them just to interrupt that, I believe. And remind them that that's not the most important thing. So we see a child's conversation and a child's calling on behalf of Jesus. And Jesus points them to a reality that I think really shuts them up. He said, you need to know for sure that you've had a child's conversion. Until you know you've had a child's conversion, you're talking about being in a place that you're not even qualified to go. You ever know anybody that's planning on going somewhere and being real important and they didn't even have an invitation to go there? I'm going to sit at the head of the table. It's like, you can't even get in the front door. Jesus tells them that very thing. He said, assuredly I say to you, unless you are converted and become as a little child, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. You're worried about who's sitting at the head of the table or who's going to be at my right hand. And I'm telling you, you don't even get in without the humility of a little child, the innocence, the dependence, the paternal love a child has toward the father. So many people worried about where they're going to sit and what their responsibilities are going to be, and they don't even have permission to come to the Father's house. You can have that permission. It's what God is calling us to understand. But you must come through a child's conversion, humbly receiving Jesus Christ by faith. What Jesus provides, you say yes to. Number four, a child's conformation. That we conform as children into the humility of a child. Because some of you are saying, well, preacher, wait a minute. I'm a grown-up. Sounds kind of like Nicodemus coming to Jesus by night, does it not? Well, Nicodemus, you have to be born again. Well, do you not know who I am? I have credentials. I have diplomas. I have respect. I have authority. I have prestige. I have wealth. I have accumulated these things. And Jesus tells Nicodemus, you can't get in the kingdom of God until you start over with nothing. Zero. You must be born again. You say, well, I got saved, I filled out a card. I got saved, I raised my hand. Listen, you may fill out a card at the moment you had faith in Jesus, but filling out a card did not save you. You may have walked an aisle. People say that often. I can say that in my testimony. I was a child when I got saved, and so I figured out, as a lot of children do, it wasn't a very long walk from the front row to the altar. So I didn't walk an aisle. I flopped, I guess. I just, there I was. But I got saved in that altar. I'd shortened the walk as much as I could, but that was not the salvation as much as the belief in my heart, the humility to come to Jesus and believe that he would save me. But I received him in the humility of a child. And what we know is the older we get, the more we gain, the more we attain to. Brother Jerry shared that a couple Sunday nights ago, that as the one who came to Jesus and had much, and Jesus said, sell everything you have and give it away, he went away sad because he had a lot. And what we have to understand is Jesus is calling us to come and be converted, and when we're converted, he's calling us to childlikeness. You say, well, I got saved, but I'm still an important person. Listen, your importance in the kingdom is not related to your importance in the world. Your importance in the kingdom is linked to your humility as a child to come in dependence to God and say, I need you, I receive you, and I want to follow you. That we conform to that child. Jesus looks at that child in verse 3 and said, assuredly I say to you, unless you are converted to become as little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom. So there is this conformity in our mind, in our image of ourselves, to be dependent upon God. And in verse 4, therefore, whoever humbles himself as this little child, and Jesus points to the child that's there, and not a child, this child. Now, I wish I knew what that child was doing. I wish it were there. I don't know what I'll ask Jesus one day in heaven, but boy, I wish I knew what he was doing. I think he was probably making mud pies, just sitting right there doodling. And I think what he probably had mud from the top of his head to the top of it. He wasn't, Now, some of y'all, when y'all read this, y'all looking a little Johnny, and y'all got him dressed like a little bow tie and little knee shorts and little white shoes. Y'all, that's how y'all got little Johnny in the picture, Oh, yeah, you just got to be cute, and you got to be, rubbing his nose and polishes, lick his hair and part it back. That's how y'all picture the kid. I picture the kid as a mess, a little terror, I think he's throwing mud balls at the disciples, and they're like, we got to be like him? Like, yeah. Why? What's his great qualification? His great qualification was Jesus said, come here, little Johnny, and little Johnny said, okay. He came. He responded to God's call in humble faith. And Jesus says, boys, if y'all just do that, if y'all just come when I call you, respond to my leadership, receive my resources, you will find that you will not only be allowed in, then he says, if you be like little Johnny here, muddy and messy, let me clean you up. Let me worry about all those things. Then you'll know what greatness is in the kingdom. Boy, doesn't it turn religion on its head? Doesn't it mess with our mind and change our understanding that this child and conforming to that in our spirit to be dependent upon the Lord in that way is what God is calling us to do? Number five, a child's commendation. Jesus says, that's it. This is what I reward, this childlike obedience. Somebody, but how can I get a star on my crown from God? How can I get a pat on my back from God? How can I get an attaboy from the Lord? Just be like a child. Just depend upon him like a dependent child. You will be the greatest in the kingdom if you have that kind of faith. Number six, a child's cultivation. He shifts gears here, not from just how we come as children. Then he says, then it depends also not on your childlikeness, but your childlike reception of others. Verse 5, whoever receives one little child like this, again, pointing to that little boy, that's why I don't believe he was all clean and spiffy, like we like to keep little kids. Like this child, if you receive a child like this, listen what he says. In my name, you receive me. So why is it so important that Bethesda, which has a long history, by the way, of years and years and years, 75 years, 100 years of people saying, I got saved as a little kid at Bethesda because my teacher at Redbud School picked me up in their car with 19 other people in a station wagon and brought me to church during revival and Vacation Bible School. And we got saved here. Or we got picked up on the church bus going through Dew's Pond area and we got saved here. Why is that so important? Because the Bible says, for those who receive little children like that in his name, we're receiving Jesus every time we do it. I've already shared, I didn't like my barbecue chicken wing get interrupted by having to go correct children. And I really didn't enjoy it the first time, and I didn't appreciate it the second and third time where I had to, I mean, because, you know, if you're going to do that, you got to try to wipe down, and that took a while. I would just rather eat. Can't I just eat in peace? Can't we just serve in peace? Can't we have adult conversations? Can't we do adult church stuff? Can't we be awfully mature and righteous? And Jesus is saying, every time you minister to these children, every time you pick one up, every time you feed one, every time you teach one, every time you reprove and rebuke and correct with love, you are doing that to me. So we see that we cultivate these relationships. I was sharing with someone just yesterday. I was talking to Brother Troy Casey and reminiscing about some times in our church history. And he was reminding me of a time where he was on a church van. He was driving a church van over there. On Deuce Pond near Brown Thresher or Cardinal or one of those places. And Brother Brock Baxter was on there with him. He said, we'd been to this place a couple times. There was a couple boys, and they were just a couple little ruffians, you know. They just roundabouts. They'd be everywhere into everything, and they'd come to church, and they'd be into everything. And he said, boys, having some trouble with them. And he said, we was nearing their house, and we looked at one another, and we had this conversation. Do you think we ought to just not pick them up today? And they said, boy, it'd be nice. What do you think? I don't know. What do you think? And they both eventually said, you know what? The Lord would probably have us go ahead and pick them up. Troy said, you know what? He said, I don't remember all the kids we ever picked up or all the names of all the kids or what happened to all of them. He said, I don't know what happened to these long term. He said, what I know is that night we picked those two boys up. He said, before the night was over, both those two boys got saved. It's important to value what Jesus says matters every time. Because it's in the moment that we don't feel like it, that we don't want to do it, that we put it off. That might be the most important moment of that child's life. So we receive them. How many times do we receive them in Jesus' name? Every time is how many times. Every opportunity, every moment to teach, every opportunity to reach, every opportunity to go and be who God calls us to be, every opportunity to show love, we do it because Jesus says we should, Jesus shows us we can, and we cultivate a relationship with these children so that Jesus can be preached to these children. Number next to last, you'll be happy to hear that part, a child's corruption, and now you won't be happy with the rest of this sermon, most likely. Because up to now, we've told you what God would have us do and what we can be, but what we also see is there is another option, and I want to present to you today, you're either exercising option one, to receive Him as a child, and to receive other children on His behalf, that's option one, or you're exercising option two, and we find it in verse 6. But whoever causes one of these to stumble. So you're either teaching them to obey all the things that I've commanded you, and lo, I'll be with you always, making and baptizing disciples. You're either doing that, or you are, verse 6, causing children to stumble and sin. And Jesus says, if you're exercising option 2, woe to you. Now, the world does this by default. The world teaches a godless view. The world teaches a hedonistic, if it feels good, do it, way of living. The world teaches all these things, but see, the church ought to be standing with Jesus as children, calling other children and teaching them not to sin. So we call them to church. We don't teach them to sin. We call them to church and teach them to live and obey the things Jesus commanded. They might not always do that. We show patience and love, but we still teach them the right way to be and do. Do not corrupt a child. Do not come down on that child in a vicious, vile way. And that's my nature, is to really come down on a child and say, you're doing that all wrong. Over 10 years ago, when this new building was new, and I'm an old preacher now because the new building is not new anymore. It's 10 years old, and I still think of it as the new building. We moved in on a Saturday. That night we had... It was either a birthday party or an anniversary, and I can't remember which it was, but Ralph and Helen Miller were there, so it was either their anniversary or one of their birthdays. And this is not about their family, because the whole church was there. And the whole church was there, and we were in there cutting cakes and having adult fun, you know, just doing all that adult stuff. And then I hear all kind of chaos out in the front hallway. And I went out in the front hallway, and they were playing the championship dodgeball game of the world in the front hallway. There were balls and cleat marks and all kind of stuff up the sheetrock and down the wall and on the doors and on the glass. And I'm like, some of y'all are old enough to remember the show Sanford and Son, where Fred Sanford was always having the big one. He's coming to see Elizabeth. That's how I felt. I thought it was the big one, Elizabeth. I was about to have a heart attack because here this brand new building is, and this brand new paint, and this clean windows and all this stuff, and these kids are out there. I mean, it was a bunch of them having a big old time. And I thought, it's the Lord's house, and you don't run in the church, and you don't play ball in the church, you don't play ball inside, and you know, all these things I was taught. One of them probably had a cap on. You don't wear a hat in the house, you know, all this stuff. And just as clear as I've ever heard anything, the Lord reminded me, we built this to be a children's building. That's what we called it from the very beginning. Fellowship Hall and Children's Building. And the children were just exercising the right to use the building. Now, that don't mean they ought to tear the place down. Y'all know how I feel about that, and y'all feel the same way. We teach them. Hey, don't run and romp, and don't run up the walls. But listen, God's not appointed us here to return to Him at the end of time or the end of our life, a pristine building with no paint chip flaws. What is our attitude? What is our impression? Because thankfully God has entrusted us the stewardship as a group of people, an inheritance spiritually, to be a part of a church that has historically ministered to children the gospel of Jesus Christ and said on behalf of Jesus, come, come, receive Him. And if we're not careful, we can corrupt children by pushing them away. We can corrupt children by fussing at them all the time. We can corrupt children by teaching them to love the wrong things. We can corrupt children a myriad of ways, but here's what I want you to understand. If you're not teaching them, he says we end up doing something that he calls being offensive. It's the same word that Jesus uses of himself as the scandalon or the stumbling block. He says we're either a positive stumbling block, putting Jesus in front of kids and making them understand that a decision must be made. And I'm not saying we bring kids here just to run up and down the halls. That's not. We bring kids here, and sometimes we let them run and romp and play. Wednesday night, I would love it. You know, the preacher in me would love it if just one Wednesday night we unload about 45 kids and they all come in, hair slicked back, with their Bibles in their hand. Teach me about Jesus tonight, brother. Boy, I'd see, feel so good about myself. Jerry'd feel great, but that's never happened. It's never going to happen. They don't do that at school, do they, Sherry? They don't come in, teach me some arithmetic today, teacher. No. They come in on Wednesday nights, and this time of year, you know what the chief question was other than do you like me last week? The number two question on the list of top 10 questions, most important things, was are we playing kickball tonight, brother? That's the high-level thinking of a child. But you know what? Jesus calls us to say, yeah, come on. Brother Jerry, we'll be playing kickball in just a couple weeks. The time's about to change. It won't be this Wednesday night. Somebody's at home listening to me. Some little kid's going to tell his brother, Junior Johnny, hey, the preacher just said on the internet we're going to play kickball in two Wednesdays. Because they don't forget if you promise them kickball. Praise God, they're coming. Now, when they come, we don't just let them play kickball and run. We put the gospel in front of them, which trips them up sometimes. Jesus says he is the chief cornerstone, which has become a stumbling block to many. But we put Jesus in front of them ahead of kickball, ahead of brownies, ahead of barbecue. It's the main thing that goes on here. And they may come for the kickball, but praise God they leave knowing that Jesus is a must-have. And we dare not ever stop. Because if we don't put Jesus in front of them as the scandalon, then the world, and then by default, we are tripping and trapping them in other ways. We bring offense into their life. Now here's where it gets weighty and heavy. If you're not teaching them that Jesus is the necessity of life, and you're not a part of that ministry of doing that, then you are a part of the ministry of tempting and trapping and tripping them in sin. Only two options in this text. We're either teaching them to obey the gospel, or we're tempting and trapping them with the trick of the other scandalon, the sin of the world. And he says, you can't outswim your example. Did you get that? You say, well, you don't understand. I've got all these abilities. I've got all these capabilities. I'm better at it than anybody you've ever seen. Double talking, double living. Whoever causes one of these little ones to stumble, it doesn't say all of them, just says one. It would be better for him to have a millstone around his neck. Now, here's what I mean by that. Some of us say, well, I can swim better than you think I can. You can't outswim your own life. The millstone of judgment is there. Don't trip and trap a kid. Don't trick a child into sin by forsaking the gospel as the most important thing ever. For all time. Verse 8 and verse 9 get even heavier if you didn't like that part. No amens there. If your hand or foot causes you to sin, cut it off. A child's correction. What do we need to do correctively? Children teaching children. You need to teach a child that the most important thing they can do concerning sin in their life, and you do this by exampling it to them, is to identify the traps of life, the sin traps. Separating ourselves from the sin trap. Pay the price no matter what it is. Learn the lesson and live. Preacher, what are you talking about? I know this is gory to think about and harsh, but this is just what it says. Y'all ever seen an animal with its paw or foot stuck in a trap? People set traps for animals. And they'll have a little spring mechanism. And it'll grab the animal, often by the foot or the paw. You know, some little mild-mannered animals just sat there and said, okay, you can come get me. I'm going to be here when you... I'll be waiting on you when you show up. But there are some animals that are smart enough to know if I stay here forever, I'm going to be dead. Best thing I can do stuck in this trap is get out of the trap. Some of them will rip the trap out of the ground and run off with it. Some animals are so viciously smart and tenacious about living that they understand the best thing they can do is eat their own paw in two or break it off just to get out of the trap. Oh, preacher, that's just gross. What are you talking about? Well, good news for you. I'm not talking about animals. I'm talking about you. And I'm not making up stories as an illustration. I'm just telling you what the Bible says. That if you realize in your life there are things that are leading children astray, your children, your grandchildren, your neighbor's children, you'd be better off to go through life one-armed, one-handed, with one foot, than to keep living the way you're living. Because you'd be better off to have one foot in heaven than to have 2 feet in hell. Preacher, what do you mean? If your hand or foot causes you to sin, cut it off. Now, again, English teachers would tell you that is a strong case of hyperbolic metaphor. A strong exaggeration, metaphorically speaking, illustrative of a real thing. I don't believe God would have you cut your body off, but what he would have you do is cut off parts of your life that are stuck. I've been pastoring here long enough that I've had a lot of hard conversations. One particular conversation, 10 years plus in the making, years ago, someone came to me and said, preacher, I've got to tell you, you're not going to see as much. See, we've made some commitments and we didn't understand what they were. And I thought they were talking about that they made some commitments here and they didn't understand what they were, because we're normally pretty good about saying, hey, first of all, get saved, you're surrendering all. If you're serving at church, you're committing to that. And I said, well, I'm sorry if we didn't fully convey the depth of the detail of the commitment you were making in order to be who God's called you to be in this place. We certainly didn't want to trap you in a commitment that you didn't need to make. And so if you need to resign, I guess we understand. But boy, I apologize if we've wronged you in any way by leading you toward overcommitment here at the church. Oh, nope, it's not the church. See, we fooled around and slipped up. That's what we do in the South when we make a mistake. We fooled around and slip up. We fooled around and slipped up, and we made a commitment to this other thing with our child. And we didn't realize the depth of the commitment we made. Wait on it. But since we're Christians and we wouldn't want to ruin our witness, we've got to keep that commitment we made. Well, what's that going to entail? What is it going to entail? We're not going to be here on Wednesdays. We're not going to be here on Sundays. And we're going to be gone a lot. And why is it you got to do that? Because we promised them. But they didn't tell you all this was a part of it? No, we just didn't understand. But it is. And so therefore, we know y'all and God will understand. And so I put on my best preacher face of understanding, and I tried. But that's been over 10 years ago, and let me tell you, I never forgot that conversation. Because God don't understand that. Now, let me help you with this. If you ever make a commitment that stands in the way of your commitment to God and God's commitment to you, then that was the wrong commitment to make. So, well, we're Christians and we gave our word. What do we need to do? You need to eat your arm off to honor your commitment to the Lord. You just sever it. Well, you don't know how much money we got invested. Sever it. You don't know how much time we've already got there. Sever it. You don't know how much of our reputation is tied up in that. Let it go. Why? If your hand or foot causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it away. It's better for you to enter into life lame or maimed, because I'm trying to tell you how to live. And the world's trying to show you how to be hindered in living and hurt and harmed in living. Because the other option is not to live, the other option is to be dead. Rather, having two hands and two feet to be cast into everlasting fire. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you. It is better for you to enter into life with one eye rather than having two eyes to be cast into hellfire. Preacher, I don't believe in you said that. Well, I'm just reading you what the Bible says. And unfortunately, I can tell you that story because that family is not in church today. Nor their children. Nor their commitment to the Lord. And they're not living. They're dying. So if you came today for me to tell you something to make you feel better about life, I think I just did. But if you came to church today for me to tell you something to let you feel better about dying, I didn't. Because God doesn't want you to feel better dying. He wants you to feel better knowing that you've done whatever it takes to identify the trap, to separate yourself from it, doing whatever it takes. You want us to forfeit that? I'm just telling you what God wants for you. Forfeit it. I've heard, we don't want to teach our kids to be quitters. You don't want to teach them to quit what? What is it we don't want to teach our children to quit? Or our grandchildren? Or the neighborhood children? Or the kids on the church van? No, we ought not teach them to quit. but we can't outswim our witness. I want to ask you to bow your head and close your eyes and stand. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord, that you love children too much for us to lead them in lies, to live before them in ways that aren't honest about priorities, about prominence. Lord, it's a question on everybody's mind. What does it take to be important forever? What it takes to be important forever is not to be the best running back of all time or the greatest politician or the most wealthy person in the world. The greatest people of all time are those who've come to Jesus in humble faith as a child. And those who are consistently reaching out to others to come to Him by faith. Other children who are lost in the world. All children are not 8 years old. Some of them are 80. And they're still lost. And God, you're calling us to live a vital, vibrant witness before them. And Lord, whatever's in our life today that needs to be separated, Lord, let us separate ourselves from it. Lord, let's be honest. Pay the price and do what it takes. Because it's better to live without whatever it is we've been chasing than to die having claimed it. God, we thank you for this day in this church and each one that's here. Lord, we pray for someone to be saved. We pray for someone's life to conform to your will. God, we thank you for the privilege of service in this place. In Jesus' name we ask this prayer. Amen. As we sing, you be obedient. You respond. The invitation today is for salvation, as it always is. The invitation today is also for prayer over some trap that maybe you're caught in, your children are caught in, to do whatever it takes to separate from it. But this may seem silly, but in the last week and a half here at the church, we've recommitted ourselves to some things concerning children, and I'm going to make it a part of the invitation for you today. The invitation is for you to put July the 18th on your calendar. That's VBS. It's on in 2021. To put it on the calendar, say, we're in it to win it. Because Sister Delilah or myself, somebody's going to be coming to you and say, we need your help. And what the Lord needs is yeses. There's an invitation to you. Yes, to Vacation Bible School. Another invitation to you is yes to Wednesday night wiping down tables. You say, that's part of the invitation. Yep. We realized here about a week and a half ago that we've been asking the youth for about 10 years to wipe down tables and vacuum carpets on Wednesday nights. They've done it faithfully. But you know what? Some of our youth have never seen their daddies or their pawpaws pick up a vacuum cleaner at the church. So on behalf of Jesus, we're saying put your vacuuming, yes, and your table wiping, yes, on the table in 2021. They hadn't seen their mamas, their mamas, their aunts, or their bus drivers pick up cloth and wipe down tables. So ladies are going to be taking a Wednesday night, and the men are going to be taking a Wednesday night. We're going to divide the efforts of the youth. Youth are still in it, but the adults are going to come alongside of the children and show them that we all love Jesus and we all love to keep God's house clean. Amen. I'm going to put one more opportunity in front of you. We've been seeing people come and young families come. Last week was a little better attendance as far as number than today, and we had a house full over in the other building. Sunday school, the nursery was full, and it was double full because we only have a nursery right now. Praise God for the nursery. We have full-time workers, first time in a long time. Debbie Bays, Dina Curtis, teaching the nursery. But we're already at the point where we need a toddler's nursery in Sunday school. We need to multiply and double. But what it's going to take is two other people, not women, just two people, man and woman, two men, two women, whatever. We need somebody to say yes to toddler nursery or yes to younger nursery. We'll work it out. Your yes needs to be on the table and ministering to children. You say, well, I thought we'd join this church because other people minister to children. Amen. But we need your yes too. So there's a way today for everybody to respond, whether it's salvation or whether it's repentance or whether it's just saying, my yes is out there. Lord, you know it's there. You call it in anytime you need it. Lord, my yes is on the table. Simple stuff like wiping tables, simple stuff like tending to children. Will you surrender it all to Him? Let's sing. Let's be obedient as we respond. All God's people said amen. It's been great to be in the Lord's house today. Remind you that we have, are the food boxes still out there at Keith, or are they already gone? The food boxes are still there. If you know of someone who needs one, or you need one, then avail yourself to that opportunity and take one for yourself or take one for others. If you have time to help deliver them this afternoon, I know Brother Keith would always take advantage of that help this afternoon, okay? Remember, tonight in the Lord's house, we have our business meeting, conducting the church's business at 5. Immediately following that is WMU and Brotherhood. Those are always important. But I want to remind you that the Brotherhood has an important in-reach event. It's going to be a cookout at TJ's house, and it's the 20th, I think. Is that a Saturday? I'm not looking at my calendar. This month, it's going to be the 20th at TJ's house. It's going to be outdoors, cookout, and it's a fellowship, but it's meant to be a revival of sorts. So we're asking you to reach out to men who are part of this church or supposed to be a part of your Sunday school in this church and invite them to that. We're going to plan it more in depth and detail tonight. So come be a part of that meeting and help plan that outreach. 6 o'clock tonight is worship. We're going to have a great time together. Wednesday, Bible study for all ages. The ladies meet in here and the men meet in the old fellowship hall. And there's room for everybody to come and be very well spaced out. I was having a conversation yesterday. Some people may not understand. There's plenty of room in these rooms for you to have plenty of space and to not be cramped. And so you come and be a part of those ministries. Go Ministries is Saturday. Sister Ronnie is leading that now. And we need your help. At 9:30, be here in the fellowship hall. We'll make up some sacked hot dog lunches, deliver those. And we're normally always done by about 11:30. It doesn't take your whole day, but it's a great blessing to be a part of that during the week. Spring Forward this week is coming up, and you can put that on your calendar, reminder, you lose that hour of sleep. I don't enjoy that part, but it'll be all right. Time's changing, and it's pretty outside today. Makes us all feel better. Those are some of the ministry opportunities we've mentioned. One of the other things I think I got in a hurry and didn't mention is Sunday school breakfast. That used to be Sunday school classes. Everything's been different. It's been being done by three individuals, and it's pared down, but it's very satisfactory, just a biscuit and some sausage and some juice. But we want to start spreading that out, okay? If you want to volunteer to be a part of a 1 month, just like when you did for Sunday school, a 4 or 5 week rotation, depending on if there's 5 Sundays in the month, a group of 3 or 4, if you'll sign up, there's a sign-up sheet. Selena has it. It'll be in both buildings. You can sign up, put your name down. You can find your own team, put it down there. If not, we'll assign you to a team. But it's very easy. If you don't know how to do it, Teresa Langston will tell you all about how to do it. She can train you. Yeah, she just got voluntold that she could be the trainer. It's not hard, but it'll take the pressure off of a few. So lots of opportunities. And that's a children's ministry as well. The adults, we can find breakfast somewhere else. We bring those children in on vans. They need to have a bite to eat so they can learn. And the adults enjoy it too. So it's a great opportunity for everybody. We're going to be praying for Brian and Marty, and they're going on a mission trip. Tell us about it, Brian.
We're going with Gerald and Peggy. We're leaving this Wednesday. We'll be gone for 10 days. We're driving down to Miami. College kids will be on spring break. Georgia Southern, Clemson, and maybe another one or two more schools are sending kids to do church planting in Miami, in the Hialeah area. And we're going down to feed them. We're going to prepare the meals, buy the food, prepare the meals, all that kind of stuff. But just pray for salvations during that time, that people will come to know Christ. Pray that God would provide us everything we need to be of service there. And just overall protection to help get us back home. So.
Thank you, Brian.
Candy?
Keith and I are traveling for work this week, so Mason will be here kicking Wednesday night, so if anybody could lend him a hand, he would greatly appreciate it.
All right.
Mason's one of our hidden all-stars in kitchen ministry and children's ministry, does great work all the time, so if you can help him this week, he could use the help. We're going to dismiss in prayer. We don't normally, but I want us to pray for Marty and Brian and Gerald and Peggy in that mission trip, and also for other things that have been mentioned today. Brother Brad, would you close us in prayer, please?
Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity to be here today. Lord, we thank you for the words we've heard. God, we just thank you for this special time with you. We just now pray that these two ministry opportunities that are coming up, God, that you would provide everything that's needed, God. You'd provide safe travel. God, that the Holy Spirit would have liberty in these ministries, God, and that there would be obedience to you. God, we just pray that your hand be around both situations. We just pray for those college students that are going to be in this ministry, God, that their hearts are prepared, that the ones that will lead these efforts down there to plant the church, that their hearts are prepared, that their hands are steady. And God, that you would be glorified in this church plant, God. We just pray for our own church ministry here, the meals Wednesday night. We just pray that the kids would come in on the vans, God, and that your love would be shown, God, and your word would be spread. Be with us this day, God. We thank you for this beautiful weather outside. God, we just ask you to keep us safe and watch over us as we travel. Also, sing and pray in Christ's name. Amen.